Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is the fifth Sunday after Epiphany. It is February the 5th. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's has a food pantry open every Wednesday from 9 to 10:45. A thrift store open Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday, 9:30 to 1. Closed on Thursday. Rainbow table every Friday, noon to 1. Everyone's welcome.
Good morning. And welcome to our worship service this morning. We give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield Park County area, looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. We prepare for worship with the order of confession and forgiveness on page 94 in the front of your worship book. So I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as we prepare our hearts and minds. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, clothe the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name.
Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen.
We now begin our worship with "I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light," hymn number 815 in the back of your worship book, hymn number 815.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church. We're praying for you as you're watching us on YouTube, and we pray that you would give your life to Jesus, let him come into your heart, let him direct your life, and you can walk as a child of the light. This was written by Kathleen Thomerson, born in 1934. The theme today is "You are the light of the world, and you walk as a child of the light."
Thank you.
to page 147 in the front of your worship book. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Singleton.
Thank you. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians, first chapter. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness, and sanctification, and redemption, in order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Starting therapy this week, that hopefully
please give your attention to part one.
Thank you.
Matthew chapter 5, verse 20. And the idea of attitude adjustment. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Religiosity. Religiosity was a problem throughout the history of Israel and Judah. Religiosity has been a problem within the Christian church. Religiosity is practicing a religion with or in excess, ostentatiously, or in a sickening fashion. It usually is motivated by someone who does not really have a commitment to God or to our Lord Jesus Christ, but instead, in order to draw attention to themselves, claim to be a follower and do all these outward actions in order to bring applause and attention to themselves. Religiosity was such a problem in Jesus' day that this is what he is confronting in our Sermon on the Mount. But to understand Jesus' point, we have to go back some 800 years to the days of the prophet Joel. In the days of the prophet Joel, Israel had a severe problem of religiosity. The people claimed to still be committed to the covenant that God had made with them through Moses at Mount Sinai. But they had got to a point where their heart was not in it. They were being influenced by pagan religions that were all around them. They were allowing those pagan practices to seep into their daily life. And they were basically taking the attitude that if we perform these outward acts, then God will be happy and we can go do whatever we want. And so over the years, the scribes and the Pharisees had made all these what are called oral laws. And these began to take precedent over the law, the Ten Commandments. What was important was all these outward rituals, fulfilling all these outward regulations, fulfilling all of these outward demands that were made and covered everything from how you fixed your food to how you dressed to what you did on certain holidays and festivals and which ones you would celebrate or not celebrate, what happened if your cow fell into a ditch or your sheep or if you by accident killed a neighbor's sheep or goat or whatever. So there were all these regulations and the people were doing those, but they had no commitment towards God anymore. So God sent the prophet Joel, and in chapter 2 of the book of the prophet Joel, verse 13, God says to the prophet, "And rend your hearts and not your garments." The word rend means to cut or to tear. Again, this was an outward show. When you were in mourning, when you had some kind of failure, when you were repenting or supposedly repenting, you would tear your robes. And that would show your sign of being humble or whatever. But it got to the point in the prophet's day that people were just doing this over anything and basically to draw attention to themselves. It wasn't because they really loved God. And so the prophet, God is saying to the prophet, tear your heart. Now there's never a commitment to me. I don't want to see this outward show of you tearing your robes. Show me a real commitment. And then he goes on and says, return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and he relents over disaster. So return, that means to turn back, to come back. It means you're going the wrong way. So the prophet is saying, God is saying to the prophet that they're going the wrong way in their faith, in their practice of their supposed commitment to him. And we've seen the same thing happen in the Christian church, where the church has gotten so obsessed over rituals and regulations and traditions and rules that we forget what the whole purpose of Christianity is, which is to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ and have faith in God through that personal relationship, relying solely on the mercy and grace of God through Jesus Christ for salvation. So oftentimes we have to be reminded to return to the Lord. Merciful means to be compassionate, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. That means merciful grace. So see, we have here in the Old Testament that same message that Jesus emphasizes, God's grace. That God gives his grace to those who believe. And he relents over disaster. That means he quickly will discontinue any type of misfortune. So this was a situation that Jesus is facing on the Sermon on the Mount. And as he's talking, there are plenty of Pharisees and scribes listening to him. And of course, they're listening to him, hoping to find something to complain about, hoping to find something in which to challenge Jesus on, hoping to have him utter some type of blasphemy or misquoting of scripture or misinterpretation. But of course, Jesus, being the Son of God, knows scripture inside out and backwards. He'll inspire it. So he knows what it says. So this is then why he says, in verse 20, "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." God wants an attitude adjustment. If we think we are righteous, if we think because we go to all the Bible studies we can go to, that we've got the Bible memorized from Genesis to Revelation, that because we go to all these retreats and do all these special things, that somehow that makes us a better Christian than others, Jesus is saying, you better stop and take a look at yourself. Because you've got the wrong attitude. That's not the attitude I'm looking for. That's not the attitude I want. I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. So what does it mean to be righteous? What is Jesus talking about? Because after all, we say salvation is by faith, through grace, not by works of the law. We say that salvation is based on what God has done, not what we do. So what is Jesus saying here? Well, one thing, problem with reading scripture is, and I can remember one of my professors saying this when we were talking about a passage in which Jesus said something, and the professor pointed out that he believed that when Jesus had said these certain words, that he was being basically humorous. And everybody, as we read it in English today, we think Jesus is being serious. But when you read it in the full context, it's like Jesus was making, basically poking fun at the Pharisees for their rigidness and for their lack of seeing what God really wants. So again, here, Jesus is speaking, but he's speaking in a way in which if you get hung up on his words instead of the whole thought that he's doing or the whole context of the Sermon on the Mount, you may think he's talking about works righteousness when he's not. What he's doing is he's putting up an example that we can't fulfill. Because our righteousness can't be better than the scribes and the Pharisees. Because just like them, we're sinful. And as soon as you commit sin, it wipes away any righteousness you might have. So what does it mean to be righteous? The word literally means to fulfill God's plans. To conform to the claims of God. Or to have right conduct in accord with God's will. So what is God's will? See, this is the key. This is where we have to know the whole context of Scripture to understand. What is God's will? That we believe in the Son, Jesus Christ. That we believe in all that Jesus Christ did for us so that God may give us that merciful grace through having faith in Jesus. And then because of that, our conduct will undergo an attitude adjustment where instead of doing things in order to try to earn brownie points, we will be doing good things to others simply as a response to that love that God first shows us through Jesus Christ. So to be righteous for us is to believe in God's gift in Jesus Christ.
he did covers us with his righteousness. So we don't have any righteousness. It's Christ's righteousness that we are clothed in that enables us to stand before God without fear and condemnation. Because he does not see our sin, but he sees his Son. He sees the blood of his Son shed for us. He sees the suffering of his Son on our behalf. So that is what it means to be righteous. Outward demonstrations of faith are useless if the heart is not committed to God. It doesn't matter how many good works you do. It doesn't matter how many Bible verses you quote. It doesn't matter how many retreats you go on or how many Bible studies you attend. If your heart is not committed to Jesus Christ, then it's all useless. You might as well do nothing. So again, that's what it is to be righteous. So faith in Jesus is what he's telling us we need. If we don't love God first, if we don't love our neighbor as ourselves, if we don't love each other as Christ loves us, then it's all useless show worth zero. So that is what it is to be righteous, trusting totally in the death and resurrection and ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ, to trust in his atoning death on the cross for our salvation. Now the Pharisees, on the other hand, they believed that you could earn salvation. That's why they had all these rules and regulations, and they fulfilled them to the letter, and they super fulfilled them, going overboard even sometimes on some of these rules and regulations. But we also see how many times Jesus criticizes them for what their actions, because as he points out, they're simply doing it to receive the adulation of the crowd, and therefore they've gotten their reward and they can expect none in heaven. And so the Pharisees believed that all those rules, regulations, and rituals were piling up credits in heaven, so that when they died and appeared at the pearly gates, there's no way St. Peter would refuse them. Of course, St. Peter, that wouldn't be in the pearly gates at that time, but when they die, they thought they'd be able to come up to heaven and stand before God and say, you can't keep me out. Look at all these wonderful things I did. Look how well I fulfilled all these rules and regulations that were man-made. See, that's the thing that we oftentimes don't understand. All these oral laws were things that people came up with. They weren't part of the covenant that God made with Moses. That was the Ten Commandments. That was a universal law. That is a law that it still is the backbone of almost the laws of every country in the world, whether they are a God-fearing nation or not. Every nation has laws against killing, against stealing, against lying, against harming your neighbor and your neighbor's possessions, or harming your neighbor's family, or the like. And so they got away from the Ten Commandments and put up all these laws they made of themselves. Same thing's happened in the Christian church over the centuries. And its worst time was during the Middle Ages, when the church added all these new demands upon Christians as to what they had to do in order to have salvation. And of course, none of them were biblical. None of them were what Jesus said. They were simply things that men made. And so we have to be careful that we do not become like the Pharisees. That we do not think we're better than somebody else. Because none of us have a foot to stand on in front of God. Unless we are clothed in the blood of Jesus Christ. Christ's teaching today destroys the idea that you can be saved by your own works, or that you can earn your salvation. And so the Pharisees obviously were upset with what Jesus was saying. So this is why Jesus says, unless your righteousness is greater than them. He was being humorous. He was kind of poking fun at the Pharisees, making a point at their expense. See, they think they're so righteous. But if you want to earn salvation, your righteousness has to be better than theirs. And they think they're top. Well, it's impossible. attention, that we put God first, that we love our neighbor as ourselves, and we love each other as Christ loved us. So what does God want? What God wants is for us, first of all, to recognize our need for God, to realize that we can't do anything on our own, that what we have are God-given abilities, and that we take these abilities and use them in our life, following the direction of the Holy Spirit. I remember way back in the late 70s, early 80s, when the U.S. and the Cold War were going on, but in the summer the U.S. would send college basketball players over to the Eastern Bloc for tournaments, for worldwide tournaments. One year, and the U.S. team went, and they had a fellow on their team who could jump so high, he was only like 6'4". But in a game against Bulgaria, he took off at the foul line, jumped over a 6'9" Bulgarian and dunked the ball. And all the Bulgarians thought that he was the result of some kind of American experiments that had made him be able to jump so high. So they were interviewing this player after the game. He said, "How can you do this? How do you jump so high? What are they feeding you? What are they injecting you with?" All these, and he just looked at me and said, "It's a God-given talent." And the player related later how funny it was, because all these communist reporters start looking at each other and gibbering back and forth at each other, because being a communist nation, they couldn't put in their paper that this was God-given talent. They denied the existence of God, but how else were they going to explain it? They said it was a God-given talent. And that's what we all have. It may not be athletic, it may not be musical, it may not be creative, it may not be artistic, but we have talents that God gives us to use. So God wants us to recognize our need of Him, not just for daily life, but for our salvation. We are His little ones. We are the sheep of His pasture. We are children of the Heavenly Father. And we need to humble ourselves before Him and depend on Him totally and completely. We are to serve Him and not be a boss or a master to others. It takes an attitude adjustment to forsake our pride and to admit the need for a Savior. And that Savior is Jesus Christ. God sent Jesus into the world to be the Savior of all people. He didn't send Him to be just the Savior of Western Europe. He didn't send Him to be just the Savior of those who lived in the Roman world during His ministry. He didn't send him to be just a Savior of a certain race or creed or color or language or ethnicity. God sent Him to be the Savior of all people, to show the world how much He loves us, that He sent His Son to undergo such a horrible suffering and death, to pay that debt of sin that we owe, so that we might be His and live under Him in His kingdom. That is what God wants. And He wants us to share that message with others. He doesn't want to, that's why He talked about a city on a hill that cannot be hid, or lighting a light in a darkened room and you don't push it, put it in a bushel basket over. You want it to shine, and that's what we're to do. See, Israel, when they made the covenant with God through Moses at Mount Sinai, was given the charge to be a light unto the nations of the world. It was their responsibility to show the world what God was really like. But as the years went by, and as they suffered through oppression from neighbors and from other kingdoms like the Egyptians and the Assyrians and the Babylonians, they became self-centered. They became introverted instead of extroverted. They forgot that charge to be a light unto the nations of the world. And so they quit spreading, for the most part, what God had taught them and challenged them to do. We as a church, especially in America, it seems, in Western Europe, are having a tendency to do the same thing. We are that city on a hill, that light in a darkened room. We are to share the glory of God, what God wants, to believe in Jesus Christ for salvation, so we cannot keep it to ourselves. We have to share it with others. We have to invite others to come and see. We have to challenge others to open their heart and mouth to the call of Christ through the preaching of his word. And then we are doing what God wants. But it all begins with a commitment in our heart that we love Jesus with our heart and not just put on an outward show. As followers of Jesus, we commit our hearts to him, not just our minds, and not by just an outward show, but by conforming to the right conduct of God's will, which begins with a life commitment to Jesus Christ, trusting him for our salvation and trusting no one else. That is an attitude adjustment we need. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us now turn to page 105 at the front of our worship books to the words of the Apostles' Creed, and I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand.
Plenty and integrity may flourish in each land and in every life. and bestow on us all that peace which only you can give. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide and strengthen those whose hard task it is to stand in harm's way in defense of life and freedom. Give them grace to refrain from evil deeds. Give them courage to withstand evil done by others. And give them competence so that through their labors, safety, justice, and hope are restored. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Shine the light of your merciful care upon those who in any way are assaulted by the powers of sin, evil, suffering, and death. Heal and restore them. Give them faith in your goodness and hope for their future, which is held safely in your sheltering arms. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Father, even as we grieve for our loved ones who have died, we rejoice that your love is stronger than death and your mercy is greater than their sin. Keep us in communion with them now through faith of your beloved Son, who died to forgive our sin and who rose to give eternal life. And bring us into the bliss of eternal union with our loved ones and with all the people whom you have chosen, called, made your own, and redeemed. And with you, our light and life, our joy, and our unfading crown. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, merciful Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Ushers today are Mary Nevius and Mindy Britton. This is the fifth Sunday after the Epiphany. The Epiphany is when the three kings came and worshiped Jesus after his birth. And we're celebrating that today. This is February the 5th, and we're honoring God's word that we are a light on a hill. We are to shine to others. The world is dark, but God has given us the light. He has sent the gospel light, and he is using us as lights to be placed on lampstands and to shine to the world, to give peace, to give safety to those who are in need, to love God and to love our neighbors, just as he has asked us to do, to be merciful. These are the things that we're called upon to do in his life, in his word. We're here worshiping, you're here worshiping, we're all together in this. We're following Jesus, we're listening to his word, we're doing God's will. We invite you to come to St. John's during this month in February. We're having church service at 9:30. We're having Sunday school at 8:30. But in March, we'll go back to the old way of 8 o'clock service and 10:30 service and Sunday school in between. On Wednesday night, we have Holy Communion in the chapel, small group. We love God and we're receiving him as we send the light, the blessed gospel light, to shine from shore to shore forevermore. In God's name, amen.
St. John practices an open communion. For all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, who believe his body and blood are truly present as we gather at his table, and are a communion agent and only individual congregation, we are invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of the Lord. Let us turn to page 152 as we continue our celebration with the grace. great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should all times and in all places give thanks and praise to Almighty and merciful God through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of the star was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of the water turned to wine, you revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise you and enjoying their unending hymn.
Thank you. body of Christ. 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 Body of Christ.
Lord, we believe we're accepting you. We have the body and blood of Christ with us. We're not worthy to receive this, but you have chosen us to and created us and given us the privilege of worshiping you, of communing with those who've gone before us. We're all communing together, we're all one in Jesus Christ. We're a light on a hill. We just shed this light to the world. The world is dark and they're in need of your grace and your love, and we need to love God and love our neighbors as ourselves. In this way we receive Jesus Christ, because as we do it to the least of these, our brothers and sisters, we're doing good to Christ, just as he said. Study his word. Music was by Felice de Giordani. God, whose mighty word, chaos and darkness heard, and took their flight, hear us, we humbly pray, and where gospel day sheds not its glorious ray, let there be light, let there be light, we're the light of the world.
Thank you.
Thank you for worshiping with us today. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. Easy to find. This is our sanctuary. You're looking at this. It's our 9:30 service. We want you to attend our garage sale. It's May the 4th, 5th, and 6th. We're already starting to prepare for our garage sale. We have to try to keep our church going the best we can. We try to serve others. We try to love God. We're doing what God wants us to do. We're feeding the hungry. We're taking care of the poor. We're worshiping God. We're taking communion. We're receiving the sacraments. We're baptizing. We're helping others. We're providing a light to the world. The world is in darkness and it needs light. Flowers on the chancel stands today are beautiful. They're given by Otto Mitterholzer in memory of his wife Sue's birthday. Sue Mitterholzer, many people knew her. Otto and Sue had a bowling program for youth at our church, a very good program. Sue's birthday, February 2nd, she's here communing with us today as we have communed with all those who've gone before us. We're all one. We're the light of the world. Thank God that Jesus gives us the power to light the world because the world is in darkness and needs its light. Flowers are also given by pastor and sons Aaron, Joel, Matthew, and family in honor of Jesus' birthday. So we have a couple of birthdays today. Gina Pollock, pastor's wife, and celebration of Sue Mitterholzer's birthday. We thank you for worshiping with us. Come at the 9:30 service during February. Then March is 8 o'clock service and 10:30 service. And we have Sunday school in between. Now for this service, the 9:30 service, we have Sunday school before the service. That's at 8:30. We invite you to come join as we are serving the poor on Fridays. We serve 8,000 meals a month to those who are in need, those who are hungry. Jesus says in the Bible over and over, we are to take care of the ones who are hungry, the ones who are naked, we take care of the poor. And when we do it, the least of these, our brothers and sisters, we're doing it to Christ. Every time we serve the poor, that's the Jesus Christ there. The face of Jesus is there. We are doing His will. Continue to help us do that. Be the light to the world. We do that through Jesus' blood, not through anything we have earned, but the grace of God. He's our Creator. Please come and join us anytime, St. John's Lutheran Church, and receive Holy Communion on the first and third Sundays of each month, festivals, and every Wednesday evening. So please come join us as God asks us to praise Him. Hallelujah.